Well, it's great to be here with you today, and I might add, it's great to be talking about the nitrogen cycle. As those of you who are not familiar with it will see, this is fun material. It's the kind of thing that allows those of us who are scientists to just say, wow, that's big. That's impressive, and it's amazing. At the same time, it's profound, and I don't expect that any of you will necessarily go out of here understanding it completely, because I don't, and I don't think anybody really does. This is just plain an amazing thing, one of those subtle things that is worth a lot of thought. I want to start off with this text. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. One of the things that probably all of us have realized at this particular point in our lives is that there are a lot of mysteries out there. We don't understand everything. We will never have all of the answers. You may even have had people in this class on occasion who actually have all the answers, but I know that I won't have them all. And you've probably noticed that they've left you feeling somewhat unsatisfied. So I will not be angry with God when we all get to heaven if he allows us to have a few mysteries to continue with. And we can pursue those mysteries with patience and so on. However, I do not believe that it is a mystery that the major systems that we see in living organisms are in fact designed. So let's talk a little bit about how we might know that a system is designed. One of the ways that has been proposed is something called irreducible complexity by a guy named Michael Behe, whom you may be familiar with. He defined irreducible complexity in this way: a single system composed of several well-matched interacting parts that contribute to the basic function, wherein the removal of any one of the parts causes the system to effectively cease functioning. So, what are the characteristics of an irreducibly complex system? Well, first of all, the function needs to be known. If you look at something and it seems very complicated, but you don't know what it does, you probably shouldn't get too excited about calling it an irreducibly complex system. Secondly, it has multiple interacting parts. By the way, and this is an important point, Mike Behe never said that every single part must contribute to in such a way that their removal, the removal of that part will destroy the function. Several parts must be necessary for the function, but not necessarily all the parts. And a good illustration of this might be the vehicle that I drove here this morning. There are some parts that cause it to function as a vehicle, the wheels, for example. However, the lights don't. The lights on my car I could brake them, and that car would drive just as well as it drives without them. Now, at night, it would make things somewhat more difficult. But there are parts I can take away from that car. But one of those parts is not the wheels. If I take away the wheels, it's all over, as far as it's concerned. So, the parts must be well matched. Sometimes that phenomenon is called specification. They must fall within certain tolerances so that they can interact in an appropriate way. And at least some of the parts are indispensable for the system to function. So the example that Mike is probably most famous for is the bacterial flagellum. And we won't go through all of the technicalities of why the bacterial flagellum is an irreducibly complex system. We'll just note that it is something that you have literally billions of in your body right now, and you can be thankful for them. That's right. They are churning around taking care of breakfast in ways that we probably don't want to think about too hard. This particular example here comes from E. coli in your gut. So here's a big question, and this is the question that I want us to just sort of struggle with a little bit this morning. You know, all examples given by Behe either reside within individual cells or at the most individual organisms. Is it possible to extend this concept of irreducible complexity beyond individual organisms? Now, let me explain quickly why it is that irreducible complexity points towards design rather than some kind of incremental process of production, like natural selection, kind of honing something in a certain direction. For natural selection to work, a function must exist. Something that doesn't exist cannot be selected for. For the function of an irreducibly complex thing to exist, it requires these multiple interacting parts. So you either have to have that entire minimal set of parts, or natural selection can do nothing. It simply can't. It has no way of selecting a goal and working towards a goal. It is a mindless process. Minds are capable of, you know, having a goal, let's say going to the moon, and then figuring out, well, you're going to need a Saturn V rocket for that, and then figuring out how to build a Saturn V rocket, and then convincing men to get inside the thing and go to the moon. That's a goal. President Kennedy set out that goal for the United States of America, and lots of brilliant minds worked on it, and that goal was achieved. But natural selection doesn't work that way. So you've got to have all of the parts to have the function so that natural selection can work on it. Now, natural selection may, in some cases, maybe, be capable of honing function or maintaining that function that's present, but it must be present already. So these are things that you simply can't come up with in an incremental way. Is it possible that there's something out there like irreducible complexity, but on a grander scale even than organisms? Now let's talk a little bit about why biochemistry is so great when we're making these kinds of arguments. First of all, biochemistry provides it allows examination of sort of the rock bottom level of life. You've all heard that cells are the fundamental units of life, but biochemists may not necessarily see things quite like that. The nuts and bolts of life are these biochemical systems. And we can understand them to at least some degree because we think we understand chemistry and physics pretty well. We kind of understand how atoms behave. So when we're talking about biochemical systems, we can have some confidence that we kind of know what's going on there. Sometimes we might have more confidence than perhaps we should, but anyway. Significant differences exist between what Darwinism claims atoms did and what atoms are actually known to do. So within the Darwinian materialistic Darwinism, let's say, the idea is that atoms have arranged themselves into you. But we don't observe atoms doing that. We observe you turning back into atoms after you die, but we don't see atoms turning into humans. We don't see them turning into frogs. We don't see them turning into sunflowers, and we don't see them turning into worms or even bacteria or viruses or anything else. We don't even see them turning into proteins. We see them doing the opposite. Now, a little bit of background on the nitrogen cycle. Air. What you're breathing right now is 78% nitrogen. And that's a good thing. There are some people who think that if we jacked up the amount of oxygen in the air, that would be good. However, remember that oxygen is what fuels fires, and if we had a higher amount of oxygen, then fires would be far worse. We'd have higher rates of oxidation and so on. So there's kind of a balance that's going on with our atmosphere. Nitrogen is a wonderful inert gas, and that's an important point. About 21% is oxygen, and then we have these smaller amounts of stuff, about 1% argon, and then of that little tiny, tiny bit that's left, there is 0.03 something or other. What is it? 0.039. So about 0.04% of the atmosphere is carbon dioxide. Not very much of it. And then there are a few other gases like neon, helium, methane, krypton, hydrogen, and so on. Now, there's something really important to keep in mind about this wonderful inert gas we call nitrogen. And that is that you can take the same molecule, the same atom, and you can put it into molecules in such a way that it is not inert at all. The example that I'm showing you here is trinitrotoluene, TNT. Trinitrotoluene is one of those things that your mother will not let you play with in the backyard. Yeah. Because when that molecule rearranges itself and those nitrogens that are on that molecule join back together, they form a triple bond. And that triple bond is very, very, very stable. What that means is there's a lot of energy released during the formation of that triple bond. That's why trinitrotoluene goes bang. You keep thinking of all the fun you could have with something like that. Nitroglycerin, same principle, and many other explosives. So here's the problem. Every bit of energy that is released when you form that triple bond has to be put back in to split a nitrogen molecule apart. That's why nitrogen is such an inert gas. You have to put a huge amount of energy in there to get it to do anything. But once you've done that, it can do exciting stuff. So it turns out that nitrogen is essential to life because much of what you are made out of contains nitrogen. Your proteins, all those amino acids that you use to make proteins contain nitrogen. Nucleic acids, DNA and RNA, contain nitrogen. We have to somehow or other get this really inert gas out of the atmosphere and into our bodies and formed into molecules that we can use that contain nitrogen. And that's why the nitrogen cycle is absolutely essential for life. Nitrogen cycle regulates the abundance of nitrogen in various forms in the environment. So it's a cyclical biochemical pathway like the citric acid cycle or the Calvin cycle, for those of you who know a little bit about these biochemical pathways that most of us at least marvel about, who do know about them. But unlike these biochemical cycles, it's distributed across multiple organisms in multiple environments. So instead of having all the bits and pieces of the nitrogen cycle inside you, those various steps in the cycle are distributed across bacteria and plants and all sorts of things. The nitrogen cycle is an ecochemical pathway that in many respects exhibits the advantages that Behe outlined in terms of biochemistry. One major difference between biochemical cycles within individual organisms and ecological cycles is that ecological cycles may involve large sources and sinks. So there are these large, big ways of storing stuff in the environment. The atmosphere is obviously a fabulous way of storing inert N2 gas, nitrogen gas, a huge source and sink right there. But there are others, as you'll see as we go along. Because it's distributed across multiple organisms, it differs from commonly used examples of irreducible complexity. And without the nitrogen cycle, it does not appear that life could exist. It just doesn't seem like a possibility. So I'm going to show you a diagram of the nitrogen cycle. If you don't understand every detail of it, do not panic. Neither do I. Neither does anybody really. But this is a general outline, and it gives a basic idea of what's going on. First of all, there is this big cycle here in the middle where nitrogen is taken from the atmosphere, and it is fixed. And then there's this nitrification in which various things are changed around. Then there's the return into an oxidized form of nitrogen called nitrate. And then it can be sort of reduced back again using this process of denitrification into the nitrogen gas that we have in the atmosphere. There are actually two other cycles that are involved here. Nitrification and assimilation are also a cycle. So it's really not a single cycle. It's sort of multiple integrated cycles. And then there is the cycle that involves assimilation. So really it's these multiple cycles that are kind of all working together to keep everything balanced out. It's pretty impressive. Let's look at a simplified version of it so that we can understand maybe some of the details of what's going on here. About 80%, remember it was 78 point something or other percent of the atmosphere is nitrogen. And nitrogen fixation, in this very simplified view that I'm showing you here, somehow or other miraculously winds up putting ammonia into plants that's used to make amino acids, and then amino acids are used to make things like nucleic acids. There's nitrification, where we take the ammonia in things, typically things that have died, and we oxidize it. Well, we don't. Bacteria typically do. It's oxidized, and then we have these relatively stable nitrate molecules that are great because they're there in the soil and so on. And then we have denitrification that puts this back into the atmosphere. And of course, we have these steps where we can take that nitrate and actually put it back into plants. Plants can absorb nitrates. That's why we use nitrate-containing fertilizers. They can take it in through their roots. And then they use energy from photosynthesis, along with some other things, to reduce the nitrogen to ammonia, and then stick the ammonia onto an organic molecule, which then gives us our amino acids and so on. And then there's something kind of interesting over here that's worth keeping in mind, atmospheric nitrogen fixation as a result of thermal shock. This is the kind of nitrogen fixation that occurs when lightning strikes or other really energetic events happen in the atmosphere. The explosions inside your cars, well, not my car because I drive an electric car. I'm better than everybody else as a consequence of that, I like to imagine. Yeah. But your cars, with their filthy internal combustion engines, when you've got that combustion going on inside there, will produce oxides of nitrogen. And those nitrogen oxides are pretty bad news. If they're in the atmosphere, we call that really stinkingly bad pollution. Primary natural source of nitrogen is biological nitrogen fixation. It is not atmospheric nitrogen fixation, that abiotic process. It may contribute something in some environments, a measurable amount, but most of the nitrogen comes from biological nitrogen fixation. It's found in almost all environments. It involves many different organisms. It's completely dependent on energy from photosynthesis. So you're going to have trouble making this happen if you don't already have photosynthesis. But remember, the nitrogen cycle is necessary to produce amino acids and nucleic acids, both of which are necessary for photosynthesis to occur. So you have a little bit of a catch-22 situation here. Another interesting thing about nitrogen fixation is that it is poisoned by oxygen, which makes it kind of difficult to... it's one more complexity that's added to this process. You don't have it going on in the presence of oxygen. And it's very complicated, so we're not going to talk about it. It in itself is a whole argument. It's fabulous. So, we're going to ask some questions about some of these different steps. Is a step indispensable in the cycle, number one? And number two, is it unbridgeable? Is there some sort of abiotic way of bridging that step so we don't need the biological mechanisms that are there? So is nitrogen fixation itself, that process of taking the nitrogen out of the atmosphere and putting it into plants, is it bridgeable by using atmospheric nitrogen fixation, that thermal shock? Maybe life could have developed in a place where there was lots of lightning and thunderstorms or something. Would that work? Well, no. And there are multiple reasons why it wouldn't work. First of all, the product of atmospheric nitrogen fixation is nitrate. It is not ammonia. at least in a in an oxygen-containing atmosphere. No, also, because no selective pressure to produce it would exist in a reducing atmosphere. You remember that one theory out there is that life developed in a reducing atmosphere, one that didn't have oxygen in it. But if you didn't have oxygen and the atmosphere was full of ammonia, why would you develop, why would there be any reason for natural selection to develop nitrogen fixation? Life would already be getting its ammonia for free from the atmosphere. Again, as its own product, which is amino acids ultimately, are required for it to work. So you're kind of putting the chicken before the egg there. And no, because photosynthesis or chemosynthesis, which first requires amino acids and nucleotides, is required for it to work. So it's hard to imagine how you would bridge nitrogen fixation in some way, how you would get it in any kind of reasonable scenario. Now, I'm not saying that somebody can't come up with something, but how reasonable that something would be, you'd have to judge at the time. What about nitrification? Remember, this is the process of taking the ammonia that's basically stuck onto things like amino acids and returning the nitrogen to the soil as nitrate. This is what happens in decomposition. If nitrogen fixation was a one-way street, all nitrogen would eventually become part of an organic molecule until either all the carbon, hydrogen, or nitrogen was consumed, or a very big fire occurred. It's probably interesting to note that there are some biological things that are actually treated as explosives because of their high nitrogen content. Bat guano being an example of that. There's so much nitrogen in the excrement of bats that apparently it has to be treated as an explosive because apparently it can explode. That would be really something to see, wouldn't it? Can you imagine that going up inside a cave and what that would look like? But anyway, life is dynamic and requires recycling and redistribution of nitrogen. It needs to be moved around and stuff. It can't all just be sort of tied up in one kind of molecule or whatever. So nitrification is pretty important. Nitrification prevents accumulation of ammonia to toxic levels and provides a reservoir of relatively inert nitrogen for plants. It can sit there in the soil and it won't blow up, it won't poison things unless it's in very high concentrations, and so on. Nitrate is soluble in water and thus it's mobile, and thus it can be distributed without toxicity issues to organisms other than those that fix the nitrogen. So this is one way of sharing the nitrogen around. This is why you put decaying plant material or cow's manure and things like that on your garden, and it grows well. It's part of the reason, anyway. It's returning that nitrogen to the soil, and then the plants can absorb it. So is it indispensable and unbridgeable? Well, nitrification requires an oxidizing environment and provides energy to the bacteria that do it. So selective pressure to evolve nitrification is absent in a reducing environment. So again, if you're starting off life by having a reducing environment on Earth, a reducing atmosphere or something, you're in trouble because this isn't going to evolve. Ammonia is relatively stable. Nitrification prevents its accumulation to toxic levels in water. That's the problem with ammonia. It is toxic. That's why we use it to sterilize things, among other stuff. It's great for cleaning. Nitrification prevents ammonia accumulation by shuttling nitrogen to relatively benign nitrate that can still be recycled into plants to continue denitrification. So it seems like a pretty important step, and bridging it in one way or another seems kind of difficult. What about assimilation? Like nitrogen fixation, assimilation requires photosynthesis to incorporate nitrogen into plants. In this case, the nitrogen pool is in the water or soil rather than the atmosphere. Yeah. Is it indispensable and unbridgeable? Well, easier ways of getting nitrogen into organic molecules inside cells seem improbable, although they would be necessary in a reducing environment. By the way, yeah, this is important. Direct importation of amino acids, at least by some organisms, is known. I'm sorry, I've left some words out there. But it appears more complex than assimilation and requires protein pumps. So to get the amino acids in, you need something that is a product of amino acids in the first place. Again, you've got a catch-22 there, kind of hen and egg situation. Well, at least a catch-22 situation. So what about denitrification? Denitrification returns nitrogen to the atmosphere by reducing nitrate to water and into the gas form. It's known to operate in waterlogged soils where oxygen is not available to bacteria. So they're actually using this as a reducing, as an oxidizer in their metabolism. It's kind of cool. In extremely arid regions like the Atacama Desert, which is supposed to be the driest place on Earth, down there in Peru, in northern Italy, northern Chile, I'm sorry, and extends up into Peru, denitrification occurs at such a low rate that nitrate accumulates, which is interesting. It's the only place that I know of on Earth where nitrate has ever been commercially mineable. And there's lots of interesting history to that. Why did the Royal Navy blockade the west coast of South America during the First World War? Because they didn't want the Germans getting that nitrate and making explosives out of it. And interesting story there. What about denitrification? Yeah. Each of these steps, we sort of run into similar kinds of issues. In the absence of denitrification, no fast method of returning nitrogen to nitrate in nitrate to the atmosphere exists. Nitrogen would accumulate as nitrate, ammonia, or inorganic molecules. And that's the last thing we want. We need to be able to keep this whole system balanced out. In a reducing atmosphere, nitrate production seems improbable. Thus, evolution of denitrification seems improbable. The reducing atmosphere idea is really, really bad for nitrogen metabolism, it turns out, even though you're getting your nitrogen for free in it. Two modern examples demonstrate these points. The Atacama Desert, where we see actual accumulation of nitrate, and eutrophication as a result of over-fertilization, where people, farmers or whatever, fertilize, put too much nitrogen on their crops. It all winds up, a lot of it winds up washing into streams and things, and those streams ultimately get poisoned by it. And the ecology breaks down. Yeah. What about atmospheric nitrogen fixation? Yeah, thermal shock in the atmosphere, like lightning or combustion within engines, produces nitrogen oxides, which ultimately produce nitrate. This is why nitrate can accumulate in places like the Atacama Desert. The nitrogen cycle is broken there. There aren't plants and bacteria and things growing there so that you can actually have biological nitrogen fixation, but you still have thermal shock producing nitrate, which precipitates out on the surface of our planet there. Yeah. This process is thought to explain the low levels of nitrogen fixation in the Martian atmosphere and suggests that it might be on the surface of Mars. Yeah, this is one of the big mysteries. Why is there so little nitrogen in the atmosphere of Mars? Probably because there's no nitrogen cycle. And there is thermal shock in the atmosphere. Various things happen up there. And as a consequence of that, the nitrogen that should be there is actually precipitated on the surface. Atmospheric nitrogen fixation could fix all the nitrogen in the Earth's atmosphere within approximately 385 million years. Now, that seems like a very long time, but it's not all that long in terms of, evolutionary time. Not very much time at all. So, a quandary results from this. Assuming an oxidizing atmosphere, within a relatively short evolutionary time, assimilation would need to produce amino acids from nitrate to make proteins so that enzymes for assimilation and denitrification could be made. But there's some time there to pull that off. The big question is that enough time? How long do you really have to make something like this happen via the Darwinian mechanism? Asking it to do a lot, and there are all kinds of estimates that you could make of these types of things. Atmospheric fixation appears to solve no more problems really than it creates in terms of bridging the need for biological nitrogen fixation. I want to stress to you that the nitrogen cycle is not something that just happens in a vacuum. There's an ecology associated with the nitrogen cycle itself. It's not a self-contained thing. There is an ecology to the cycle itself. So if we have the nitrogen cycle, and we just draw it as an arrow, it's one of the great things about biochemists. They can do miracles with arrows. Yeah. We have to have photosynthesis, because photosynthesis provides the energy that ultimately gets this thing going. Photosynthesis also provides the organic molecules that are involved. So if you are doing nitrogen fixation, the whole point of the nitrogen fixation is to stick nitrogen onto an organic molecule so that you can then make amino acids. If you don't have the organic molecule, which comes from photosynthesis, your nitrogen cycle is merely going to produce ammonia or something, and you achieve nothing. So you've got to have both of them, their products both combined together to make these things. Now, note that if you're making amino acids, the amino acids are necessary for both the nitrogen cycle and photosynthesis. Furthermore, the amino acids are necessary to make nucleotides, which are the building blocks of nucleic acids like DNA and RNA. And then, of course, those nucleotides also play a role in energy metabolism. They, in and of themselves, are necessary for photosynthesis and for the nitrogen cycle to work. So it's really an integrated thing, isn't it? There are all kinds of things that are all dependent on each other, and they all kind of zip together. And then, of course, the information that's stored in nucleic acids is necessary to make the proteins that are necessary for both of these processes to work. And finally, I'll mention, obviously I'm scratching the surface here. We're really not going particularly deep, but the proteins are necessary for all other organic molecules. And it's pretty cool. Pretty cool and amazing. Yeah. And proteins, obviously, for the nitrogen cycle. So here are some conclusions, at least, that I've drawn from studying this. First of all, the nitrogen cycle looks tentatively like an irreducibly complex system. It's kind of difficult to pull out one of those major steps in there and have the thing function for very long, have life function for very long. But it's more complex than systems found within individual organisms. It's a pretty complicated thing. And that's why I'm not claiming that I really understand it. My guess is that, you know, as time goes on, there are going to be all kinds of interesting subtleties in this that come out as these things are studied more. Its distribution across multiple organisms and environments creates complexity, lowering the degree of certainty about conclusions. Because it's something that I don't really think we should claim that we fully understand, we want to be a little bit more tentative about it. Immense sources and sinks of nitrogen and nitrogen compounds on Earth suggest that the entire system did not need to come into existence contemporaneously. And that might be it's time limited, but you know, if every organism that does nitrogen fixation, for example, died today, life, it seems, could survive at least for a little while. At least for a while. Not forever, but for at least a little while. To differentiate systems of this type from established irreducibly complex systems, we propose the term irreducible interdependence. And I use the word we here for a very important reason. I was not the only person who came up with this idea. Former friend, well, that's coming out wrong, isn't it? My friend and colleague, who has now passed away, Henry Zuhl, and I actually developed this notion. So I really want to give him credit here. He was really a sort of driving force in, as we worked together on thinking this thing through. One of the reasons that we suggested irreducible interdependence is because we wanted to have a different term than irreducibly complex, because it really isn't exactly the same. We didn't want to burden irreducible complexity with something that is a little bit fuzzier, a little bit different. Irreducibly interdependent systems require that a complete set of organisms that participate must have come into existence within a limited space of time. This does not fit with any developed Darwinian scenario, at least that I know of. It does fit well with a 6-day or some other time-limited creation. You know, it doesn't prove the 6-day creation true. It doesn't prove fiat creation true. But it does say, you know what? Whatever happened to produce this nitrogen cycle must have occurred in a significantly time-limited way. It's like using the word recent creation instead of 6,000 years, isn't it? Anyway. So those are my thoughts. I don't know if you have any questions or comments. Or did I completely bamboozle you, Nancy, with that nitrogen cycle? Yeah. Yes. You know, sometimes I wonder, why was it that God let me be a biologist? It's not that it isn't tough, but wow, you know, imagine being something else. You know, I can't think of anything more satisfying or amazing. It's every day, every paper that you read has something that should make your jaw drop. It's so incredible. It's a true tragedy when a biologist loses that sense of wonder and amazement at what they do, you know, what they get to study.
You're saying nitrification and denitrification. Uh-huh. Without both of those, you cannot have interesting life on Earth.
Well, without both of them, it's hard to imagine how you would keep things balanced out. You know, it's a very buffered system. And if you start accumulating any of these, it's much easier to understand these things when you think about biochemical pathways and metabolic diseases of various kinds. You know, most of the genetic diseases that I can think of off the top of my head right now, and this is dangerous, thinking off the top of my head, but most of those diseases involve the reduction in function or elimination of function of a specific enzyme. And so you have a biochemical pathway. There are different steps along the way, and most of the time we don't think about them because what our bodies are concerned about primarily are the beginning point and the product, what you start with and what you get at the end of those pathways. But if you break one of the steps in between, you're going to get something building up. So you have diseases like PKU, phenylketonuria, which all American births, I believe, now are tested for. It's a problem with the metabolism of the amino acid phenylalanine. And as a consequence of that, you get a buildup of one of those products in the middle, a metabolite in the middle. That metabolite happens to be neurotoxic, and so if you build it up, the child who has that problem will develop mental retardation. It's actually controllable using diet. You simply stop feeding the kids phenylalanine. And so they have to live on a special diet, especially during the early part of their lives, so that they don't develop this problem. That's why babies are tested for it. But that's just sort of a biochemical example of when you have something building up inside an organism, it can be and often is a significant problem. If you have something building up like ammonia in the environment, I can't imagine anybody thinking that's a good idea. Locking up or nitrate, I mean, any of these things, it's just problematic if you have them building up in the environment. And yet, nitrogen is absolutely essential for life. The atmosphere can distribute it around in fabulous ways. It's readily available, except that it's locked away because of that triple bond. So you kind of have to have everything working together to keep things balanced out.
Just to finish up my question here,
yeah.
Do you have an estimate of how long it would take to destroy life if we didn't have this cycle? In other words, the constraint to a 6-day creation is not as strong as a constraint to billions of years. Where's the figure in there?
Yeah, I really don't have an estimate. And probably that would be an interesting thing to work on. It would be a bit tough to, even if I did have an estimate, I wouldn't want to be too dogmatic about it. Obviously, there are, you have a lot less than that 385 million years or whatever it was that I said for just thermal shock removing nitrogen from the atmosphere. The reason being that, let's say, I shouldn't say that. It would depend probably on which step in the cycle gets stopped. There'd probably be different amounts of time, I would guess. However, if biological nitrogen fixation was occurring, it might be significantly less time, because you're still pulling nitrogen out of the atmosphere. But precisely what?
To use your term, this is very cool. Okay. And so what I'm wondering is, are you working with anybody to try to animate what you have presented today? Number one. And number two, would you be willing to work with people to put this in a form that a 9-year-old could begin to say, this is very cool?
I'd be happy to work with somebody who is interested in doing that, yes.
Okay.
That would be a really great thing to do. All of these ecological cycles are pretty awesome.
I think they would just go over really well for an 8 or 9-year-old if it was animated, and not animated in a stupid way, but animated in a way that makes it enticing and draws them in. Okay.
And nitrogen's kind of like Superman. Really powerful when he goes off.
Yeah. Tim, I want to thank you for this very provocative pattern you have presented this morning. Please, do you know whether Michael Denton has commented knowledgeably on this whole thing that you have presented as something that has come together?
Not that I know of. Most of the discussion when it comes to design type stuff that I've been involved with has involved essentially biochemical systems. But ecology, because there's this fuzziness in ecology, I think people have been a little bit hesitant to go there. And quite frankly, I've been trying to think myself of another ecological cycle that might illustrate this same principle. I can think of individual examples of what I would call irreducible interdependence. But these grand global ecological cycles, like the water cycle or the carbon cycle and so on, nitrogen is just pretty unique.
Well, I mentioned Denton's name because, as you well know, he was perhaps the forerunner when he wrote his book, Evolution, A Theory in Crisis.
Yeah.
That was the book which Philip Johnson read, one on sabbatical, that started the whole intelligent design movement. Yeah. And Denton did not write from a religious perspective at all, rather as a chemist and a scientist, who increasingly became aware that the very properties of basic elements were remarkably integrated to make life possible. And so, speaking not as a religious scientist, but as an observer, he was challenging the world of science to rethink evolution. And,
well, particularly the Darwinian mechanism.
Yes. that you're probably very familiar with that first book that Denton wrote, but more recently he wrote a book, Nature's Destiny, which is a rather obscure title. But he goes into the details of examining the subatomic properties of carbon atoms and why they have to be exactly the way they are in order that carbon can serve as the basis for the organic molecules.
Yeah, the long chain organic molecules. This is something that I know I've read others, discussions of. Because there's been this idea that, for example, silica or something might form an equally good basis, silicon, for life, but it
Denton dismisses that silicon idea.
Yeah. Mm.
And what he comes down to in this more recent book, as you may know, he is now a senior fellow in the Discovery Institute. His bottom line conclusion is awesome, in that it's not just interdependence, that your term, which is great, at the biological level of organisms, which are interdependent, but he's saying that can only have its origin in the nature and precise magnitude of nuclear forces, subatomic forces. Mm-hmm. So you see, he is presenting, in fact, for you and me, all of us, a creation that was fine-tuned in its most elementary properties, at the subatomic properties.
Yeah, you know how Jesus talked about those having ears to hear quite a bit. One of the reasons that I find not that the Darwinian mechanism, frankly, doesn't bother me at all, but this sort of philosophical orthodoxy that seems to be being sort of forced in the public discussion of these things is incredibly unfortunate, because it blinds people to much of the truly amazing stuff that's out there, when you have to explain it all as, well, it kind of happened by natural causes or something. Well, if it did, those natural causes are pretty amazing. By the way, I do think that things do happen by natural causes, but nature itself is awesome. But in addition to that, the way that those fundamental things about nature can work together to produce, ultimately beautiful works of art and, music and minds to appreciate those things and love and
consciousness
and it just goes on and on and on is pretty awesome.
I'm wondering about the regenerative powers of nitrogen. The earth waxes old like a garment. Rachel Carson and Silent Spring, polluted waters. Beijing, you can't breathe. People are dying. Genetic entropy, it's all mixed together. Does the earth fight back? Does nitrogen try to reclaim?
Well, I'm not sure that I'd give nitrogen impute a kind of consciousness to it. However, I would say this.
Is it disappearing?
The kind of examples, that you're giving really illustrate how we can tax our environment and tax our bodies. The miracle to me is that people can survive it. Organisms live through these unbelievable assaults One of the things that you see in life universally is that it is robust. It is not brittle in any way. And I think about myself because, well, I'm me. So that's who I think about. But, you know, I've on occasion injured myself. One time I managed to lacerate my right lung and collapse it. So I had to survive on my left lung, which is only about a third of your capacity, and because your heart is displaced, to the left. And you know what? I was able to do it. I was able to survive it. Wow. It's just, there's, you know, I don't think that my mother had more children because she had two lungs, but I'm alive because I did. You can cut whole organs out of human beings, take the appendix out, you can take their spleen out, you can take their thymus, I don't know, Bernard, how many organs can you remove from a human being and still have them alive and functioning? It's awesome.
Well, you really don't need two kidneys, do you?
Yeah, you can. The redundancy, the robustness that is built in there, that really is pretty hard to explain in terms of merely producing more offspring. You know, if you want to make a faster car, what do? You start stripping stuff off. You don't go to a racetrack and see cars with the you know, big, soft, comfortable seats that cars have in them. You don't go to, NASCAR cars, they don't even have headlights. They're missing all kinds of stuff, but they go faster. So if we're just trying to make more babies and win that game, I don't know. Two kidneys seems like one too many. A waste of effort. Unless you want to make organisms that can survive and enjoy life and beauty and all the rest of it. It's pretty humbling.
I'll make one comment before we go on, and that is that it is now 11:30. I know some of you have other places you need to be, but for those of you who can stay, you're welcome to stay and ask questions of Dr. Standish as long as he is willing to take them.
Sure. And he'd better be.
Go ahead.
I find it, the comment about for a 9-year-old, interesting, and that my 8-year-old nephew just brought home recently some material in which man is the cause of all evil in the environment, and it's fairly anti-human in what the environmental part of these biology classes are trying to push, in which they keep blaming humans for everything bad in this world. And it brought to mind that Christianity and Darwinism are so opposed to each other philosophically, between the survival of the fittest and God's continual admonishing us to take care of the poor and the innocent and the vulnerable. And those two philosophies are so against each other. I hate to see our whole generations raised in here with human beings being the cause of all evil, because it certainly leads to mental justification of genocide and other things, because humans are bad and they're raised that humans are bad. In a lot of this, as opposed to what you present with how phenomenal this creation is and how fascinating biology is and how the focus on a God that created this and cared so much about us and provided all this is such a different approach than what my nephew's being taught in the public school approach.
Yeah. You know, one I've been struggling with why it is that these people have such a, you know, such a problem with human beings. I mean, I look around, you're all pretty good looking to me, you know. Surely human beings are at least as fabulous as, I don't know, daffodils or something, something beautiful, you know. I mean, beautiful and intelligent and wonderful. It isn't that we're incapable of doing awful things, but why is it that there's this kind of obsession with everything being anthropogenic, global warming and so on? And by the way, I don't want to get into a discussion of global warming and whether it's true and whether it is anthropogenic or not. I mean, I'd like to know if it is, and I'd like to see us do something about it if it is. But, of course, I drive an electric car. If it was powered by nuclear-generated electricity, I guess that I'd be innocent. But anyway, there is one flavor of Darwinism that I've heard expressed by some people. Jacques Monod, for example, does it quite enthusiastically, where it turns out that by sheer luck, we happen to be at the top of the pile. And what that means is we get to decide what's good and what's bad. We are the gods of this universe. And the problem with being the god of this universe is that then you're responsible for everything. And all of a sudden, you know, whereas with Christianity, we put the thy will be done, not our will be done. We don't think we know better than God. We know that God has the whole world in his hands, and that ultimately, you know, we can trust him. That's not to justify doing things that destroy his creation. So Christianity, the Christian approach to things, is a very balanced and optimistic approach to reality. Even when everything ends, it begins. That's the new creation. You know, but yeah, you know, it's very disturbing to hear these people. The interesting thing is, they rarely seem to act on their beliefs. You know, if they were going and having mass suicides, like some of these kind of, you know, cult, yeah, that would make sense, I guess, in some way. But you know, this may seem like a change in subject, but I really don't think it is. You know, I look at what's going on with in the Middle East right now, and particularly in Syria, where this just abomination is occurring, and the way the world is responding to it, it's heartening to see those who are, you know, welcoming and helping these poor people. But how this sort of stuff can go on in the world without a massive reaction is really extraordinary to me. And this is, it's not like this is the first time or something. I grew up in Thailand during the Pol Pot era in Cambodia. It was extraordinary to see how people responded to that. Some in very noble ways, and others almost with a shrug.
In his book, What's So Amazing About Christianity, does a nice, interesting comparison as people criticize Christianity and they pull out the Salem witch trials and they pull out the Inquisition and so forth. And if, at the risk of misquoting, but I believe that he said over 500 years we have perhaps with the Crusades, et cetera, 200,000 plus deaths that we can attribute to a misguided Christianity or however you would look at that. And if the anti-theists are going to scream and holler about that, then we should at least take a look at the last 50 years and the 100 plus million deaths associated with atheistic governments and say, well, if you're going to point the finger, it's not a better odds under this type of an approach. And I'm afraid that we have, when we lose the accountability to something greater than ourselves, we lose the ability to respond to the tragedy of others as we should.
Well, that's true, but I think there's something even more fundamental about it. Why would a materialistic Darwinist say that it's a bad thing that a couple of hundred thousand people died, or 100 million people died? Why would that be bad? First of all, people are bad. But secondly, hey, those were the weak. This is, evolution is a death-driven process. Evolution is about a struggle for survival that some are not supposed to survive. So, why is death bad? It's good. It's what made you. People get furious when people start comparing Darwinism to Nazi ideology and all the rest of it. And the bottom line is, I suspect that pretty much all religious ideologies can be twisted in that way. Because I think that history testifies to that. People who claim to be Christians have done dreadful stuff. In the name of the Lord. People who claim to be Buddhists have done dreadful stuff. It's pretty hard to argue that at least the vast majority of Japanese were Buddhists who did what they did in the most horrific ways to other people.
And they started training those children in elementary school to go to war and to fight like that. I worry about what we're training our kids in our schools with some of the textbooks that are so anti-human in their approach. It sets up a world that is very vulnerable for violence against humans without conscience.
Yeah, well, I mean, if I was a sincere Darwinist, okay, I'm not saying that every sincere Darwinist would have to be this way. I'm just saying if I was one, I would reasonably see my purpose in life to perpetuate my genes. I can't think of any other. So that makes you my enemy and your wife my potential bearer of my genetic offspring. Yeah. And and all of you, every male should be going after every other male and raping and pillaging as hard and fast as they possibly can in the hope that they perpetuate their genes. I mean, if that's what it's all about.
But I think they feel like we finally reached an area where we are more empathetic and understanding and we have oxytocin in our body. I don't know. we're caring now. So now we're at a different level.
But that's maladaptive. I'm sorry, you know. How does that make me have more children?
Take it too far and eliminate your
pride. Yeah. You know, it's not like I'm quoting stuff that is uniquely you know, to me or something like that. This is what Darwin himself talked about, and by the way, not only in The Descent of Man. Can I find it? I mean, this may be a foolhardy act, but I'm going to try to do it. I was just looking at a well-known Darwin quote, and yeah, here it is.
Can you search for it?
Yeah, that's what I'm going to do. The well-known Darwin quote is, "I would give absolutely nothing for the theory of natural selection if it requires miraculous additions at any one stage of descent." So this is actually a little bit out of context from a letter that Darwin wrote to Lyell in 1859. Okay, so this is when they're talking about the origin of species and everything. Oops. I'm going to try to look it up on Darwin Online and give it to you in context, because I'm pretty sure this was the one. Complete Works of Charles Darwin. This is...
While you're looking that up, I think it might go along with this. I don't know if anybody's ever noticed, but how well the philosophy of that era led itself in to a superior race, Aryanism, and eugenics of that time period. And if you look at the pictures that they will put to a Neanderthal and they will put to a primitive man and the way they draw their things, I have sat across a train from a lady from Africa, and I could have photographed her profile and put it up against what they put. And you wonder how much, since most of them were white at that time, the philosophers, how much racism played into their descriptions of what primitive man looked like to us now. Because I could take those pictures and I could put them with people alive today that come from different races and made them match up. And I wonder, it seems awful racist the way they went at it, and awful leading toward Hitler's Aryan nation type approach to life, that certain races were more superior to others.
Yeah, let's not be too hard on Hitler. Remember that much of their thinking about racial hygiene was based on stuff that was done here in the United States. I mean, that's the shocking thing about it. It's just absolutely incredible what was going down here in the United States during the 1920s and 30s with the eugenics movement and all the rest of it. Let me just read this to you. You know, this is what Darwin was writing the year that The Origin of Species was published. As far as I understand your remarks and illustrations, you doubt the possibility of gradations of intellectual powers. Now, it seems to me, looking to existing animals alone, that we have a very fine gradation in the intellectual powers of the vertebrata, with one rather wide gap, not half so wide as in many cases of corporal structure, end brackets, between, say, a Hottentot and an orang. Even if civilized as much mentally as the dog has been from the wolf, I suppose that you do not doubt that the intellectual powers are as important for the welfare of each being as corporal structure. If so, I can see no difficulty in the most intellectual individuals of a species being continually selected, and the intellect of the new species thus improved, aided probably by effects of inherited mental exercise. So he's being kind of Lamarckian there in his comment. But I look at this process as now going on with the races of man, the less intellectual races being exterminated. But there is not space to discuss at this point. Blah, blah, blah. You know, I mean, the you don't need Darwinism to be a racist. But as far as I can tell, Darwinism forces you into one of two ditches. Either you are a rabid racist, and obviously human beings are dehumanized as a consequence, or you deny completely any special place for human beings in the creation, and the life of a human is worth no more than the life of a squirrel.
And for those who love the global warming, they're going to hate me for saying this, but there are several comments that I've listened to by people that are concerned that that we have focused on the global warming and told developing countries you cannot develop your stuff because it'll hurt the environment, while leaving people in abject poverty and more disease because they don't have the advantages that those things could bring to them. But then, you know, the ramifications of this type of thought process, where we value humans less than other things, is wide-ranging and causing awful, horrible things to be done in this world.
We Westerners have been champions at using technologies when they worked for us and denying them to people who need them. Silent Spring was mentioned here. Yeah. We used DDT as much as we wanted. Just blew it everywhere, filled up our environment with it. Well, it certainly worked for us, and then we want to deny it to people in Africa who are dying, you know, where there are still zillions of people dying of malaria. I understand maybe helping people to use these kinds of technologies in ways that are less destructive than the ways in which we use them. But, you know, the denial of the use of DDT has cost the lives of, I don't know how many people, but I've seen different estimates. I mean, we're talking about millions. And don't get me wrong, I'm not going out there advocating, you know, spraying the entire world with DDT or something like that. But I am saying, wow, when it was good for us, we used it all we wanted. But, sorry, Africans, you don't get it.
Was it ever really good for us, though? We didn't know that it wasn't good.
Oh, it's great. I mean, look, DDT is like a miracle. It's phenomenally inert in human beings. Yes, you can poison a human being with DDT, but you have to, I mean, they used to give it orally to clear out worm infestations. Yeah. And topically, yeah, to get rid of fleas and stuff like that on people. I mean, it's just amazing how well it works. you know, not perfect, not perfect. We probably used it excessively. In fact, we did.
And that did cause. And overreacted after that, over.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, exactly. You know, people, they used to drive through neighborhoods just fumigating the whole neighborhood with DDT. That was probably a bad idea. That's why you get problems with, you know, DDT building up in very high levels in predatory birds and those sorts of things. And you get the problems that result from it. But used responsibly, DDT is not that bad of a thing.
I just wanted to build a little bit on what he was saying. Look at, if you go back to Planned Parenthood was based on, yes, Planned Parenthood was based on.
It's a eugenics project.
Right, there you are. Mm-hmm. And no one talks about it. No one talks about it.
And every statistic from Planned Parenthood, I mean, it's just revolting.
Yes.
It's, you know, and that's a whole can of worms.
You know, how many years ago was it in St. Louis? There was a world exhibition there. They had a man, a pygmy or someone tied there, and this is subhuman being, you know, we're mother.
Oh, yeah, they have no right at the St. Louis World Fair.
Right, yeah, right.
I mean, he wound up belonging to the Bronx Zoo or something, poor fellow. I mean, it's just...
Right, and what he did to himself probably killed himself or who knows what. But, you know, you look at what's happening in Syria and other places, I think, to me... It might be a design. They want chaos so that out of chaos comes total control. You can see this coming.
Yeah. Who's they that wants it?
You mean specifically? Sure. Look at the Pope. ISIS. Look at the Pope himself. Forget ISIS. ISIS, I think they don't even know what they're doing. But I think it's a design thing that they want it. They want chaos. So. Now the Pope is giving in, well, for 1 year you can go ahead and have abortion as much as you want to, and after that year, after December 8th and 9th, you cannot do it anymore. Or even he's compromising, taking the church whichever way, and I think out of this whole chaos is going to come control.
You know,
by the Pope.
Yeah. By the Pope, yeah, by the same person.
Back when I was in high school, this is going to shock you all. Yeah. So this group, Black Sabbath, they produced an album called Dehumanizer. Right? I've never listened to it. I couldn't give you any idea of what it sounds like. Doesn't matter. The point is that we had multiple presentations at my school about the evils of rock and roll and the evil, and Black Sabbath was just a Black Sabbath, the Rolling Stones, you know, they were sort of, they're basically Satan incarnate, right? Here we have a situation in our world today where we have two ideologies, this evil permutation of Islam and Darwinism, both of which are actual dehumanizing philosophies. I don't hear anything about it. Yeah. It was bad, apparently, for Ozzy Osbourne or whoever it was who was singing for them at the time to sing about dehumanization. But, you know, we're not, you know, when you just don't see the same level of angst. What's happened to us? What's happened?
60s. Here's
the terrifying thing to me. When I was a kid, you know, I wondered, is this really... real. I mean, are the eagles really holding satanic masses over the masters of their master recordings of their albums in the hope that this will bring them worldly success? Or is this some kind of cultural overreaction? Well, I think the answer is absolutely clear right now. That kind of stuff was made up out of whole cloth. People didn't like it because it was an assault on a cultural thing. Now, I'm not saying it was good. I don't want to defend what was going on at the time. But talk about shooting at exactly the wrong target. Going after something that you find shocking or offensive or whatever, instead of going after the underlying profound philosophical problem that will result in actual dehumanization, is where the you know, I mean, the I can tell you that what it did was it sent away a generation of kids who were completely cynical.
Right. And what's going to happen to the next generation?
No. Well, that's what we need to pray for. That's right. Why we need to be out there doing stuff. That's right. Why, you know, Anita is absolutely correct. We've got to do stuff that 9-year-olds can understand.
Right. Right. No, we've got to. Yeah. Nine-year-olds can understand so that our schools and all over the world, looking at what's happening, I believe that the Lord will, he's still on the throne, he'll always be, and he will make things black and white. People will be able to make a choice. And, you know, it might be Ben Carson, it may not be Ben Carson. I'm just mentioning that name. But the Lord will use his people all over the world to make things happen, to be black and white, so people can make a choice.
But
the whole thing is
don't you wonder whether people will be capable of making the choice? It's very interesting. Back 20 years, what was it, 30 years ago Waco occurred? When Waco occurred, I asked people in my practice, what do you think of Waco? Because it was in the news every night. I didn't say what I thought. I just said, what do you think of Waco? And there was a group of people that said flat out, this is not right. This is not what my government's supposed to do. I'm very worried about this. There was another group of people that said, yes, you know, they believed what they were told and they should be wiped out. And it went right down age groups. It was phenomenal. Whether you were pre-Vietnam or post-Vietnam in your age group, which one of the two sides you picked. The older you were, the more you said it is absolutely wrong. The younger you were, yeah, they believed what they were told and this group ought to be wiped out. I'm not so sure, if you look at the global warming issue, how many people have actually looked at the data and tried to make up their mind off the information available,
You can round it to zero.
Yeah, I'm afraid you're right. I mean, if you choose to, you can go on YouTube and hear people of different opinions express it and give their data so you could think. But when I talk to my children's generation, they just accept it and don't go look. Don't question, don't do anything of that for themselves to think. So the ability to critically think could get so lost that at some point,
which is ironic because that's supposed to be a major goal of teaching nowadays.
I believe so. And perhaps that's what happened before the flood, where the Lord finally said, nothing else is going to happen. Maybe in the time of the end, we're going to get to the point, because I think the Lord wants everyone for eternity he can possibly get there. But at some point, humanity may go to the point that there is no one left that can even recognize, hear the voice of God, see him, or critically think to understand, to respond, and there's no reason to wait.
But before you end, I'd like to be able to go there on the 26th of September. It's a Sabbath in the afternoon. If indeed we know where to go, maybe some of us will try.
You know what? If you follow GRI on Facebook, we've put the link to get tickets. The tickets are free.
Okay.
And they're just a way of so that they can have an idea of how many people are coming. But the Plummer Auditorium, it's a fair size. If you just Google Plummer Auditorium.
Is that the same one that they used last time? So it's a very large auditorium.
Yeah.
Been there.
Can't miss it.
but or Google Illustromedia, or let me see.
Okay, Illustromedia, I know that.
I can give you, if you want, the... the exact URL. If you get our newsletter, you may also be...
Oh, he needs to go. Okay.
Yeah. Let me see.
What is it? I can write it down for him.
Well, it's kind of long. That's the problem.
Oh.
I'm going to put it up on the...
on the screen.
Yeah.
There you go.
That won't be perfect, but it will be something.
Okay.
Yeah. There's the URL to get tickets. Yeah. I'm sorry for the numbers and things, but if you go to livingwatersthefilm.com also, or just illustramedia.com, I'm pretty sure you...
Livingwaters.com.
Yeah. Livingwatersthefilm.com, I believe. No spaces or anything like that.
Waters Paul.
The film.
The film.
Dot com.
Great.
They'll probably have it there.
If not, I'll walk over to your office.
All right.
I want to.
There you go. I can run, but I can't hide.
Yeah, I want to.
Hey, thank you very much.